When I was in college, I took a course in creative writing. I often wrote stories with a science fiction or horror theme, as those were what held my attention at the time. I remember the teacher once commenting that authors can introduce one big lie into their fictional tales, but everything else must follow logically from that lie. So, for example, when Stephen King wrote of a haunted hotel deep in the Colorado High Country, tended only by a man and his family during a snowed-in winter, the lie was the haunting, and everything else, the characters, had to react in a logical, believable way to this big lie. I recently was explaining to my daughter the story of Noah and the biblical flood. I was pointing out the fact that children's versions of the tale often lack the more horrific details of the original. One thing occurred to me that had never occurred to me before. Why did God make Noah take the animals aboard the ark? In the first chapter of Genesis, God completely populates the earth with plants, sea, and land creatures in the short span of 3 days. I suppose I could understand why God spared Noah. In the Bible, human beings are the divinity's special creations, made in the image of the Creator. The earth had been formed for man. No reason not to wipe it out. Mountains, seas, forests, jungles, etc., along with all the animals, they were merely there as helpmeets. Why not reward the only man in his family who had remained loyal to the big guy? Indeed, Noah's righteousness is exactly why God chooses him to survive this catastrophic second creation of the earth. But the animals? Animals cannot be counted as righteous. Animals no more further the plot of the story than does the mention of what sort of wood Noah used to build his ship. Indeed, the animals actually hurt the story of the Great Flood. Skeptics of the biblical tale have long pointed out the problem taking animals aboard the ark creates for the size of the ark, its seaworthiness, its capacity to hold two of every animal on earth, and so on and so forth. Ironically, creationists like those at Answers in Genesis point to other flood stories as found throughout the world as evidence of the historical truth of the biblical flood tale. But while these other stories might include a canoe or other small vessel, and maybe a handful of animals, usually creatures necessary to human beings like sheep, cattle, or dogs, the authors of these yarns were wise enough to steer clear of adding an absurdly gargantuan ark and the impossible number of animals to their tales. Had such absurdities found their way into these other stories, I might add, then perhaps creationists could claim that they were all a collective memory of a very real historical worldwide flood. With such details ignored in these stories, however, the creationists have nothing but an interesting collection of flood tales from around the world, useful for anthropological studies but not for verifying the inerrancy and historical accuracy of their preferred holy book. Some may argue that the animals were necessary to force Noah to build such a large ark, which would, of necessity, have taken many years. In that time, those watching the construction of the craft and the reason for its massive design, they may have had a change of heart, turned toward the Lord, and joined Noah on his boat. But the ark needn't have changed their minds. Remember, the big lie of the Noah story is that there is an omniscient, omnipotent God, and he is going to cause it to rain and flood the earth for the wickedness of mankind. God could have merely given Noah miracles to work to convince the unbelievers, as he does with Jesus in other stories later in the Bible. He could have made the sun stand still, as he did for Joshua, or sent a plague or two, as he did for Moses, or even sent a few bears on a killing spree, as he did for Elijah. Adding the unnecessary burden of all those animals and the construction of an impossibly large ark, in the end, sinks this fantastic tale. If I, as a reader, recognized these logical problems with the big lie in the story, there was obviously a failure on the part of the author to create a coherent tale. Seems, if the Bible were indeed authored by an omniscient deity, he should have joined me in my college creative writing course and learned a thing or two about authoring believable fiction.